And we're live. Hello, good evening. I'm gonna give my gang a chance to come in. I hope you're all doing well this evening. And thanks in advance to everyone who is joining. I am your moderately glamorous, slightly disheveled host, Emma Langford. Be sure to throw in a comment in if you're joining. Let me know where you're joining us from. And we have a lovely show coming up tonight. I'm really, really excited. Some lovely comments already. How's it going, everyone? Hey, Cynthia, throwing in a bit Irish. Lovely to have you here. So tonight's theme is songwriters. So we're celebrating songwriters. And there were a few obvious candidates for that category. And there are a few less obvious ones. So I hope there's something for everyone in here. Hello, Joe. Thanks for joining us from Chicago. And Jim from Chicago as well. Thank you all so much for coming along. Our cause tonight is a very special one. It's Sera Husky and Animal Rescue. So Sera Husky and Animal Rescue are an amazing organization in the County Kerry. They're somewhere called Lisselton, which is very near Listowel, if any of you know it. And hello, everyone. Thanks for coming in. The sunny shores of Carlo. Thank you for making the journey to our live stream. So Sera Husky and Animal Rescue are special because not only do I love dogs, not only is that why they're special, but they also rescue donkeys and hedgehogs and turtles and snakes and pigs. They're just brilliant. So I'm very happy to be supporting them tonight. But also, on top of all of that, I visited Sera Husky and Animal Rescue there in January for himself's birthday. And we learned that the animal rescue is exactly as old as our relationship is to the day, I believe. Which is wild. So that was a lovely discovery to make. Hello, everyone who's joining in. Hi, Angela. Hello, Jerry. Hello, everybody. You're all brilliant, wherever you're joining us from. All right, so I'm going to start tonight's sing song with a nice, easy one. This is a song by a songwriter called Annie DeFranco, who I discovered a few years ago. My older sister left a CD lying around at home, and I started listening to it, and I just became addicted to her work. So I'm going to sing you guys this song. It's a nice, strong one to start on, and it's easy as well, which is great. Where am I at? Where am I at all, lads? I'm all over the place. There we go. So this is 32 Flavors by Annie DeFranco. I'd love if you'd let me know how it's sounding and how I'm looking, because this is a new setup. I'm using a new laptop, and so I'm not 100% sure how it's going to sound and look. So let me know what you think. Hi, Anne-Marie. Thanks for joining. All right. Squint your eyes and look closer. I'm not between you and your ambition. I am a poster girl with no poster. I am 32 flavors and then some, and I'm beyond your peripheral vision. So you might want to turn your head, cause someday you may find that you're hungry and eating all of the words you just said. Da 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 da. Yeah, yeah. Da da da. Both my parents taught me about goodwill, and I have done well by their names. And the kindness I've lavished on strangers is more than I can explain. Still, there's many who've turned out their porch lights just so I would think they were not home, and hid in the dark of their windows until I'd passed and left them alone. And God help you if you are an ugly girl, cause too pretty is also your doom. Cause everyone harbors a secret hatred for the prettiest girl in the room. And God help you if you are a phoenix and you dare to rise up from the ash. 1,000 eyes will smolder with jealousy while you are just flying past. Da 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 da. Da 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 da. Yeah, da, 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 hey, oh. I'm not trying to give my life meaning by demeaning you. And I would like to state for the record, I did everything that I could do. I'm not saying that I am a saint. I just don't want to live that way. And I will never be a saint. But I will always say, your eyes and the closer, not between you and your ambition. I am a poster girl with no poster. I am 32 flavors and then some, and I'm beyond your peripheral vision, so you might want to turn your head, because someday you will find that you're starving and eating all of the words you just said. Squint your eyes and look closer. I'm not between you and your ambition. Da 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 da. Da 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 da. I am a poster girl with no poster. I am 32 flavors and then some. Da 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 da. Da 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 da. So that's a bit of Annie DeFranco, 32 Flavors, great song. She taught me an awful lot about, can throw in your comments whenever I see them. She taught me a lot about playing guitar and kind of ways to approach it and that kind of thing. I hadn't heard her music growing up, and then I hit my 20s and found this CD by her, and it was a revelation. She's amazing. Thank you all so much for tuning in. Hi, Philip. Thanks for joining us from Wimbledon, just around the corner from my older sister. Bernd says there is a slight delay in the picture after the sound. Okay, that's worth knowing. Thank you, Bernd. Really appreciate it. Also in my 20s, I discovered an album called Hades Town. I'm a little blurred. Oh, no. That's okay. There's not much I can do about the quality of broadcast this evening, unfortunately. So we'll have to just put up with it, if that's all right. and if it gets very bad and very distracting, do please let me know, and I will I'll switch to a different. I might use my phone or something to stream instead. Okay. So speaking of Annie DeFranco and discovering new music, I discovered this next album also in my 20s. It's called Hades Town. And it was actually Carl Corcoran on the Blue of the Night on Lyric FM played one of the songs from this album on his show, which is very missed. I really miss hearing Carl Corcoran's voice on the radio. But he played one of the songs from Hades Town, and I remember hearing it and just being blown away by it. So I went and Googled it and had a look at what other songs are in the show or in the album. And so the album is a concept album written by Anais Mitchell, who's an incredible Canadian songwriter. And I think she's Canadian. Sorry, that could be totally wrong. I'll make sure. I might have that wrong. And she's American. So she'd written this incredible concept album about Orpheus and Eurydice going down to Hades, and that whole story of, you know, if he looks back when he hears her calling, he'll turn to a pillar of salt. You know, it's really beautiful, tragic story. I was gonna play this one. This is Flowers, also known as Eurydice's Song, and it's her song of regret. She's made some bad choices. She's been pushed into some bad choices, and she's wondering where her love is, where Orpheus is. So this is her song, and you know, I'd love to have the full full band effect around it, but unfortunately. What I wanted was to fall asleep, close my eyes and disappear, like a petal on a stream, a feather on the air. Lily white and poppy red, I tremble when you lay me down. You will feel a thing you said when you go down. Nothing's gonna wake you now. Dreams are sweet until they're not. Men are kind until they aren't. Flowers bloom until they rot and fall apart. Is anybody listening? I open my mouth and nothing comes out. Nothing gonna wake me now. Flowers, I remember fields of flowers, soft beneath my heels, walking in the sun. I remember someone by my side, turned his face to mine, and then I turned away into the shade. Ever walk this way, come and find me lying in the bed I made. So that is Flowers from Anais Mitchell's concept album, Hadestown. I cannot strongly enough recommend that you all go and check out that album. It is incredible. They did an NPR Tiny Desk in the past few months, and NPR shared it this week, and it just it made my life complete. It was so beautiful. Yes, Cynthia, you're right. They won the Best Musical Tony last year, which was amazing, and so deserved. All right, I'm gonna bring in my first guest of the night, actually, now. We have five guests tonight. I said I'd go all out and play. Philip, I will absolutely play that song for you, no problem at all. It might be a little bit later in the show, if that's all right. I love seeing all your comments, by the way. Thank you all so much for tuning in and for being part of tonight. It's really special. So I'm gonna bring in our first guest. Our first guest is Miriam Donohue, who is an incredible songwriter. And I've got five incredible songwriters joining us on tonight's live stream. I'm very lucky to call these people peers in the music industry. And so here's Miriam. Hello, Mrs.
Hi.
Hi, how are you doing?
Good, how are you?
Lovely to have you. Thanks.
Thanks for asking.
I can't complain.
Good, good. Yeah, cup of tea. There's a cup of tea.
Where are you joining us from?
I'm in Wicklow.
Can't beat it. Oh, brilliant. Cool. And how are things in Wicklow? How's the lockdown restrictions are lifting at this stage everywhere, I think. How's it looking there for you?
Yeah, same here, but it's actually been kind of nice just to lay low and, you know, chill out and, you know, live a simpler life maybe a bit slower. So yeah, I've kind of been enjoying it really. Yeah. You?
Yeah. I'm the very same. I'm inherently introverted and really love, I'm very comfortable in my own company. So yeah. I'm just gonna change up the comments on the front here. So you have been designing face masks and headbands. You're modeling one for us there. It's absolutely beautiful. That's your Frida Kahlo.
It just started, like, I work in costume for film and TV as well as doing the music. So when lockdown happened, I just thought I'd start making a few masks, and it kind of exploded. Like, I didn't realize there would be such a demand for them. So but I'm still trying to donate where I can to other makers who are doing stuff for, like, people in direct provision and carers and that. So just still trying to keep that community vibe to it. But yeah, I've kind of gone into business making stuff like this now, just to keep busy. You know yourself, you know, you got to be resourceful in times like these, like, where, you know, yeah, the creative people, you know, we're all in the same boat where everything's changed with work and income. So yeah,
you're dead right. I think it's a really interesting time for a lot of people. I've seen people coming back to old hobbies and coming back to crafts that they never had gone near before, now that they have the time and the space and the resources to do so, which is really gorgeous. You know, it's obviously you wish that people didn't have to be forced indoors and in fear of a pandemic to do it. But
no, I know it's like,
sure, look,
it's the silver lining, I suppose, in it, is that people are maybe going back to themselves a bit more and have a bit more time, maybe with their kids or their family, or, you know, themselves, their creativity. And yeah, they have to find the good in it, because otherwise, you know, it's a tough time for a lot of people as well, you know.
Yeah, for sure. So what song are you going to play for us tonight?
I'm going to do Trick of the Light by The Villagers. I adore Conor O'Brien's writing. I think he's just such a poet. He's just fab. And I love this song. I love the video for this song as well. I don't know if you've seen it. It's but there's a friend of mine, Brian Quinn, BQ, he's in it. And it's just beautiful. It's just a lovely video. And yeah, I just love this song so much. So I hope I do it justice.
Brilliant. I can't wait to hear your version of it. I'm going to take myself out of the stream and hand it over to you. Thanks, Miriam.
Thanks, Sam. Okay, give this a go. My heart is spilling over. It's crashing on the ground, and I can't see what's around me, but soon I'll come around. My faith is in the balance of a million tiny words, so I'll return to silence. And if I see a sign in the sky tonight, no one's gonna tell me it's a trick of the light. May never come, but I'm willing to wait. What can I say? I'm a woman of faith, and there's an ocean in my body, and there's a river in my soul, and I'm crying. And it's time that I let go of the things I can't control. This path that I have taken is the only one I know. Well, I've come so far to get here, and I've got so far to go. So I'll take what I can get in the matters of the soul. And if I see a sign in the sky tonight, No one's gonna tell me it's a trick of the light. May never come, but I'm willing to wait. What can I say? I'm a woman of faith, and there's an ocean in my body, and there's a river in my soul, and I cry. We are the dawn, and we carry the sun. We are the dawn, and we carry the sun. If I see a sign in the sky tonight, no one's gonna tell me it's a trick of the light. May never come, but I'm willing to wait. What can I say? I'm a woman of faith, and there's an ocean in my body, and there's a river in my soul, and I cry. And if I see a sign in the sky tonight, no one's gonna tell me it's a trick of the light. May never come, but I'm willing to wait. What can I say? I'm a woman of faith, and there's an ocean in my body, and there's a river in my soul, and I'm crying. And there's an ocean in my body, and there's a river in my soul, and I cry.
Yeah. That was savage. Loved it. It was exactly as beautiful as I expected it to be.
Ah, thank you. Thanks very much.
Really fab. It's a fun, I think Connor's work is really interesting to interpret because, I mean, his voice is so distinctive, so no matter who covers his work, it's impossible not to make it your own because nobody sounds quite like Connor, you know, yeah, which is really interesting. But you're right. His lyrics are really interesting. He's a real poet. I've actually picked one of his songs to do myself tonight as well to celebrate his work because it deserves celebration. But you yourself are a fabulous songwriter and you do your own gorgeous stuff. Have you got anything new coming out in the next while or have you been... My nightmare question right now is, oh, are you writing? Because I'm not.
Yeah, like I have stuff that I haven't released that I need to work up and, you know, get out there and stuff. But yeah, I'm not putting any pressure on myself at the minute. So, but yeah, there's always stuff, isn't there, to do. Yeah, but I love this format, Emma. Like, fair play to you just to say for putting together this because musicians have had to, you know, adapt. And this is kind of nice, actually, you know, from the comfort of your home, you can reach out to so many people. It's lovely, you know.
Yeah,
so.
No, it is. It's really special. It's kind of, on the one hand, you know, it's awful not being able to meet people in person and play tunes. Yeah. But on the other hand, this has broken down a lot of barriers for me in that I'm much more comfortable reaching out to musicians to join me on a live stream. There's no personal expense to them for traveling to be part of a gig or anything. Yeah. And you get to just kind of chill out and, you know, for all I know, you're just sitting there in your knickers and a nice top. Like, you know, it's handy. And yes, you can do that at gigs, but you shouldn't.
Brilliant.
Thanks so much for being part of this tonight, Miriam. If people want to check out your music and support you, what can they do? Where can they go?
Bandcamp. I've got an album up there called Paperscapes. I'm on Facebook and Instagram and the usual spots as well and YouTube. But go along to Bandcamp and that'd be great. Thanks, Mel.
Fabulous. Brilliant. Thank you so much for joining me tonight and I'll chat to you later.
See ya. Bye.
Bye, Mrs. Oh.
Thanks, Trina.
Removed me instead of Miriam. Oops. I'm an awful clown. If you want to support Miriam and check out more of her work, and I highly recommend you do, I have a copy of her album here at home as well, and it's such a beautiful piece of work. Just gonna move my camera a little bit. Do check her out. She's got it's called Paper Trails.
Let me see if I have it. I should have it here somewhere.
have like a beautiful collection of Irish musicians CDs here, but I can't find, I think it's up in a, I like a fancy shelf up there of CDs that look really pretty, so I think it's up there. But yeah, check her out, Miriam Donohue. She's tagged in the description of all of these posts, and she is so paperscapes. Thank you, Miriam. Paperscapes, like escapes, but with paper. So yeah, go check out Miriam's stuff. I'm going to play you guys another song from Conor O'Brien, aka Villagers. He's one of Ireland's finest musicians, easily, and he's also really sound and completely cracked. Go find him on Twitter. He's very, very funny. So this is Becoming a Jackal. I'm just going to make sure I have it in the right key. Becoming a Jackal. Yeah. Yep, yep, yep. And this is actually dedicated to my best friend in the world, Deirdre Carey. When we were in college together, we used to play these tunes together on the guitar and do harmonies and all kinds of lovely stuff. So, yeah. The most familiar room. Every implement was leading to you and your homely sense of disarray. Never once the same. Always rearranged, but things would never change. In the scene between the window frame, where the jackals preyed on every soul, where they tied you to a pole and stripped you of your clothes, I was a dreamer, staring out windows, out onto the main street, 'cause that's where the dream goes. And each time they found fresh meat to chew, I would turn away and return to you. You would offer me your unmade bed and read me till I'm red, feed me till I'm fed. And when the morning came, you would catch me at your window again, in an eyes wide open sleeping state, staring into space with no look upon my face. I was a dreamer, staring out windows, out onto the main street, 'cause that's where the dream goes. When I got older, when I grew bolder, out onto the streets I flew. Released from your shackles, I danced with the jackals and learned a new way to move. So before you take this song as true, you should wonder what I'm taking from you, how I benefit from you being here, lending me your ears while I'm selling you my fears. I was a dreamer, I'm selling you my fears, staring out windows, selling you my fears out onto the main street, selling you my fears, that's where the dream goes. I was a dreamer, staring out windows, out onto the main street, 'cause that's where the dream goes. I'm selling you my fears, I'm selling you my fears, I'm selling you my fears. He's a fucking fabulous songwriter, so he is. Hello, 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 all of you. Thank you so much for joining us. Hello, Leash People One. How are things? All right. This next song was a request from Jerry. But I was singing. I was singing it to myself for no reason at all. And then the next minute I see a tweet asking me to do this song, which was really weird. Get out of my brain. So this is Sea of Love by Cat Power. A nice, simple little one. Come with me, my love, to the sea of love. I wanna tell you how much I love you. Do you remember when we met? That's the day I knew you were my pet. I wanna tell you how much I love you. The sea of love. I wanna tell you how much I love you. Lovely one. Now I'd often be asked to sing that one at the weddings, all that kind of thing. So I am going to do a song now by the Divine Comedy. Divine Comedy, aka Neil Hannon, one of my favorite songwriters of all time, and he's got a couple of lovely songs. He's got Songs of Love, he's got a song called Everybody Knows Except You, and that's the one I'm going to do. I went to see him live a couple of times, and he has a new song recently enough, it's probably not recent. It feels recent compared with his other stuff. But his more recent song is I Like, which is a really fun song, really up-tempo and great, and just listing all the things that he likes about the person that he likes. But he released this song years and years and years ago. Everybody Knows Except You, or Everyone Knows Except You. And it's like this unrequited, undeclared love story. And when he's telling the story of his new song, I Like, he's like, you know what? I listened back to that song that I wrote years ago, and God, I was a jackass. I was such an asshole, because I was there singing a song about someone that I loved that I'd never actually told I loved them, and then kind of almost making them feel guilty for not knowing it, which was a fun perspective on a song that I hadn't heard before. But this is Everyone Knows Except You. One of my favorites. Where are we? Am I in the right chord or key? Everybody knows. Ah, okay. That will start. Okay. Everybody knows that I love you. Everybody knows that I need you. Everybody knows that I do, except you. I told the stars above about the one I love. I told the morning sun, yeah, I'm telling everyone. I told my mom and dad, they seem to understand. And I'll get through to you if it's the last thing that I do. 'Cause everybody knows that I love you. Everybody knows that I need you. Everybody knows that I do, except you. Everybody knows I live for you. Everybody knows I adore you. Everybody knows that it's true, except you. I told all of my friends again and again and again. I drove them round the bend. So now you're my only friend. I told the passersby. I made a small boy cry. And I'll get through to you if it's the last thing that I do. Everybody knows that I love you. Everybody knows that I need you. Everybody knows that I do, except you. Everybody knows I live for you. Everybody knows I adore you. Everybody knows that it's true, except you. I'm going crazy, baby. What do I have to do? You know I love you, baby. Maybe you love me too. Everybody knows I live for you. Everybody knows I adore you. Everybody knows that it's true, except you. Except you. How come everyone knows except you? Except you. Everybody knows that I do. Except you. Yeah. I wish I had a cool voice like Neil Hannon so I could like speak the speaky bits in that song and not just sound like a big idiot. Angela Maxwell says she's singing along, and that is what I like to hear, because this is a sing song and singers are all well and good being up here on camera and singing their stuff, but the whole point is that you all enjoy it. And Philip Cashin says that song reminds him of himself. Love it. All right, I'm going to bring you guys our next guest, which is very exciting. So our five guests tonight, our first one was Miriam Donohue. She is fabulous. She's an incredible songwriter. She's living in Wicklow, and she's well worth checking out. She's got an album called Paperscapes, which is available on Bandcamp. Our next singer and songwriter and performer and guest is probably not going to be any stranger to a lot of you. She's kind of a big deal. This is the incredible Leslie Dowdall.
Hello.
Maria.
Good evening, it's to Limerick.
How are you getting on?
I'm good. This is kind of funny, isn't it? Bizarre, but great. I'm fantastic.
I know.
Thank you for asking me.
Oh, such a delight to have you. Such a delight to have you. So I've been seeing some of your live streams. Oh, sorry. Sorry, I talked over you there.
No, I was singing along with you, but fitting we can't do it together. I was singing along with you with the lovely.
I know, it's the one thing I miss when we're doing these things, that you can't actually like jump in and sing harmonies with someone, because it's what I love about singing, is actually singing with people.
Yeah. Just have to wait for that one.
Well, yeah, we'll get together. It'll happen. Mike Hanrahan is determined to get myself, yourself and himself together for another project.
Brilliant.
Sometime.
So gorgeous.
I have to do that. So I've been watching your streams, and you've got some gorgeous horses.
Thank you. Christy Moore and Boy George.
Of course, that's what they're called.
Yeah.
Are they so named because their personalities match their namesakes?
There's a bit of that. Boy George is a bit of a poser, and Christy's a bit of a fella.
Didn't know where that was going. Love it.
Yeah. Be careful now.
Yeah, And what was I going to ask you? So tonight's cause is Sera Husky and Animal Rescue. And obviously animals are caused close to your own heart.
Yeah.
That's obvious.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. That's, we did the last little Facebook live with the stable for my lovely horse rescue. It was quite fun. We had great fun. I think it's great that everyone's been kind of, everyone's opening their game and trying to reinvent ways of doing Facebook live. And what you're doing is fantastic. Well, you know, it's putting us all, it's challenging us all, but it's great.
That's the way.
Doing this, yeah.
Myra Clancy says hello. She says, you're looking great.
Thanks, Myra. I've actually a friend of mine, Emma, from Ed Reynolds. He's a painter. He used to be in a famous band, Punks, in the 90s, and even on Top of the Pops. But he saw your poster and he said, oh, I know a few of those people. And he said, son of Hound, that he knows Ed is a painter now. He paints these amazing murals all over Belfast. And he said that son of Hound, I don't know the boy's name, man's name, he comes to their studios in Belfast.
Oh, brilliant.
To say hello to him. And also say hello to Shane Hennessy. I met him one day, I was playing a gig in Carlo, and he was there with his father, who was running the gig, with a gorgeous man, and Shane was so lovely and humble, and I said, oh, do you play guitar? He said, ah, yeah, I just play a little bit of guitar. And then I saw him, he's like, incredible, incredible. But his loveliness was his humble. He's so humble, but he's amazing. Yeah,
he is. He's a dote. You're right. He's an incredible performer. And Son of the Hound then is Mick. I'm sickened. I can't get everyone into the one room for these things, because I know that everyone will get on so well and have such a nice time. But sure, look, we'll make do with what we have. What song did you decide to perform for us tonight?
Yeah, sorry, I wasn't a bit mysterious or anything. Sorry, I didn't know what I was going to do. So it's not necessary. It's not necessary. Well, I wouldn't pick this woman at all as my favorite songwriter, but a good song is a good song. So this is actually a song by Rihanna called Stay.
Oh, amazing.
So I've done loads of favorite songwriters, but one of my biggest ones would be Annie Lennox, which I'm surprised I didn't do any of hers. And Bonnie Raitt would be another one. And Sean Colvin, kind of a lot of singer-songwriters. Yeah, the older school. But and now that I've learned the new school, I'm probably Emma Langford. I loved you doing the song with your mum. I thought it was amazing.
Oh, thanks so much, Leslie. It's been really lovely having you on screen and in the comments. It's been really nice seeing you around. All right, I'm going to hand the screen over to you and let you give us a blast of Rihanna.
Great. Thanks a million.
Brilliant. Thank you.
Sorry, Emma, the microphone's not working. Oh, it's gotta come back. Sorry about that. Here we go again. It's live.
All I was a fever, cold sweat, heart of a believer. Threw my hands in the air, so show me something. He said, if you dare, come a little closer. Round and around and around and around we go. Tell me now, tell me now, tell me now. Now you know. I'm really sure how I feel about it. Something in the way you move makes me feel I can't live without you. It takes me all the way. Want you to stay. It's not much of a life you're living. It's not something you take, it's given. Round and around and around and around we go. Tell me now, tell me now, tell me now. Now you know. I'm really sure how I feel about you. Something on the way you move makes me feel I can't live without you. It takes me all the way. Want you to stay. Ooh, ooh. Like the mama's hold on. Funny you're the broken one, but I'm the only one who needed saving. Cause when you see the light, it's hard to know which one of us is caving. I'm really sure how I feel about it. Something on the way you move makes me feel I can't live without you. It takes me all the way, wanting you to stay. I'm really sure how I feel about it. Something on the way you move makes me feel I can't live without you. It takes me all the way, want you to stay.
Voila.
That was class.
Thank you.
That was so cool. Oh my God. I shared a little video on Instagram there of myself doing some harmonies in the background. Of you.
Oh, brilliant. Right. Look forward to hearing it.
You did it. We broke the system.
Right. So, Emma, have a fantastic night. And thank you so much for asking me. And I hope I'll be listening for the rest. And thank you.
Absolutely. My love to Henry there and to Danny as well.
Okay. Well, have a great night.
What a woman. Huh? What a woman. That was Leslie Dowdall, who is an icon of the Irish music scene, to say the very least, an absolute hero. I remember when I was just kind of starting in music and I was trying to find, you know, women in Irish women in music, you know, who's out there, who's doing what's going on, how can I spread the word about those women as well. And I was creating this playlist on Spotify and putting together all these amazing artists, including Miriam and tonight's guest Tracy Bruen, and then I came across Into Anua and the voice of Leslie Dowdall for the first time, and completely blew my mind. She was just this incredible powerhouse of a voice, and I've gotten a chance to work with her a few times since. She's always been so lovely, so welcoming, so warm, and just ridiculously cool, to be honest. It's just not really fair, and an absolute right. So she's got it all going on, to be fair to her now. Right, moving on to a couple more songs, and then I'm going to take a short break. Actually, we're taking a small intermission tonight because I've got back problems and I can't sit in one place for too long. So the song I'm going to do before we take a break is a Laura Marling song, if I can find it. Just a reminder as well to everyone that tonight we're raising funds for Sera Husky and Animal Rescue, which is an incredible animal rescue. They look after dogs, donkeys, snakes, hogs, hedgehogs, turtles, everything out in County Kerry. So do please throw a few quid in the PayPal link. Let me see if I have the PayPal link here. I'll get the text to it. Yes, amazing. So everything you chip in is divided. So I do pay my artists because it's important that artists get paid for their work. Right now, gigs are not happening, and so merch sales are not really happening either. And so it's really important that that artists can survive and we can keep doing these kinds of things. But also we are donating to Sera Husky and Animal Rescue. They're an independent, very small, for some reason that link didn't share. An error occurred in this broadcast edition on Facebook. No. There we go. Well, you guys let me know if you can see that link coming up on Facebook. For some reason, it's not sharing. And if you guys would do me a big favor and maybe share the PayPal link in the comments so that anyone who's new to the stream can see where they can chip in, that would be really helpful. Thank you so much. They're a small independent animal rescue in County Kerry and they need our support right now. They've been doing amazing work in looking after dogs that have been surrendered or dogs that have been abandoned. Morris out there has been collecting those poor pups and making them feel safe and warm and getting them to good homes. All right, so this is a Laura Marling song. It's called My Manic and I. Okay, cool. That's good. That's coming up. Delighted. Sorry, it's not, it's saying here that there's an error. So it's lying then. yeah, this song has always been one of my favorite songs. It's a very dark, very dark song. He wants to die in a lake in Geneva. The mountains can cover the shape of his nose. He wants to die where nobody can see him, but the beauty of his death will carry on. So I don't believe him. Morning is mocking me. He greets me with kisses when good days deceive him. And sometimes we're scorned, and sometimes I believe him. And sometimes I'm convinced my friends think I'm crazy. Get scared and call him, but he's usually hazy. At 1 a.m, day is not ended. By 2 he's scared that sleep is no friend. And by 4 he will drink, but he cannot feel it. Sleep does not come because sleep does not will it. And I don't believe him. Morning is mocking me. I'll wander the streets, avoiding them eats, till the ring on my finger slips to the ground. A gift to the gutter, a gift to the city, the veins of which have broken me down. I don't believe it. Morning is mocking me. And the gods that he believes never fail to amaze me. He believes in the love and is God of all things, but I find him wrapped up in all matter of sins. The drugs that deceive him and the girls that believe him. I can't control you, I don't know you well. These are the reasons I think that you're ill. I can't control you, I don't know you well. These are the reasons I think that you're ill. And since last that we parted, last that I saw him, down by a river, silent and hardened, morning was mocking us, blood hit the sky. I was just happy, my manic and I. He couldn't see me, the sun was in his eyes, and birds were singing to calm us down. And birds were singing to calm us down. And I'm sorry, young man, I cannot be your friend. I don't believe in a fairy tale end. I don't keep my head up all of the time. I find it dull when my heart meets my mind. And I hardly know you, I think I can tell. These are the reasons I think that we're ill. I hardly know you, I think I can tell. These are the reasons I think that I'm ill. And the gods that he believe never fail to disappoint me. And the gods that he believes never fail to disappoint me. My nihilist, my happy man, my manic, and I have no plans to move on. My nihilist, my happy man, my manic, and I have no plans to move on. And birds are singing to calm us down. And birds are singing to calm us down. So that was Laura Marling's My Manic and I, which is a very poignant, beautiful song. For me, and I don't know about you guys, maybe you can let me know how you interpret it, but for me, that song is about her struggle with her mental health and kind of being almost having a Stockholm syndrome with your struggles with your mental health, kind of feeling like those issues and those things that you struggle with are part of you in such a way that you don't want to let go of them. And that you can develop this kind of toxic, unhealthy relationship with that side of yourself sometimes. So I think that song is a really beautiful way of kind of describing that experience. And I've always really connected with it. Found it really powerful. All right, I'm going to take a bit of a break. Just a quick 5-minute break. We'll be back very shortly with another few guests and some more beautiful songs. I've got something by Josh Ritter. I've got some Joni Mitchell. I've got some Declan O'Rourke. Wallace Bird, we have some Steely Dan coming up. What else do I have? Let me see, there's my lovely sheet with names. Oh yeah, Foy Vance, Beatles, Gillian Welch. So there's a bit of everything in there. So I hope you'll join us in 5 minutes time. Take this chance to go for a wee. And yeah, I'll chat to you in a few minutes. Hello again. Thanks for sticking around, you guys. Oh, sorry, Anne-Marie. I see there that I've put in a toilet break when you don't really need one yet. We'll maybe take one again later. Apologies for that. All right, so got a couple more songs for you guys, and then we're going to bring in our next guest. First one I'm going to do is Josh Ritter's Girl in the War. Apparently my microphone got very quiet after Leslie left. So do please feel free to drop a comment if my sound has disappeared, if my mic has vanished or the sound has gone very quiet. Let me know in the comments and I'll do my best to fix it here. There's only so much I can do, but I will do my best. And thanks everyone who's tweeting and sharing on Facebook and YouTube and Twitter. You're all very good. So yeah, this is Girl in the War by Josh Ritter. He has been a very influential songwriter in my life. I suppose one of the first songs I wrote that took off in any kind of way was The Seduction of Eve. And it was heavily influenced by, well, it was a direct response to Josh Ritter's song, The Temptation of Adam. So this is Girl in the War. Oh, that's a bit out of tune. Sorry, that'll drive me nuts.
Peter said to Paul, you know all those words we wrote. They're just the rules of the game, and the rules are the first to go. Now talking to God is Laurel begging Hardy for a gun. I got a girl in the war, man, I wonder what it is we've done. Paul said to Peter, you gotta rock yourself a little harder. Pretend the dove from above is a dragon and your feet are on fire. I got a girl in the war, man, the only thing I know to do is turn up the music and pray that she makes it through. 'Cause the keys to the kingdom got locked inside the kingdom. And the angels fly around in there and they can't see them. But I got a girl in the war, Paul, I know that they can hear me yell. If they can find a way to help her, they can go to hell. If they can't find a way to help her, they can go to hell. Paul said to Peter, you gotta rock yourself a little harder. And the dove from above is a dragon and your feet are on fire. I got a girl in the war, Paul, her eyes are like champagne. They sparkle bubble over in the morning, all you got is rain. They sparkle bubble over in the morning, all you got is rain. Sparkle, bubble over in the morning, all you've got is rain.
Virginia wants to know where, for anyone who's not watching on Facebook and isn't seeing the comments popping up there, if you're watching on YouTube or Twitter, Virginia Ann Flanagan asks, where you guys saw me playing live, if you have seen me play live. Pop that comment up here. All right, I'm going to do a bit of Joni now. A little bit of Joni. I see my pal James is in the comments. Hello, James. You guys might know him from Cork as James Orr. If you know him personally, you might know him as Jimmy. He's a brilliant songwriter. And he does his own weekly sing songs over on his Facebook page. They're called At Home Again, Naturally, which is very clever. Yeah, James is a... He's a lifelong friend of mine and a fabulous musician. Very lucky to call him a friend. Now for a bit of Joni. I'll try and get rid of these sleeves a little bit. My guitar is not in tune. It's really annoying. Right, I'll give it my best shot. My tuner is not working on my guitar for some reason, and it's all a little bit out. But sure, look. Ah, lads, I can't wait to see you all in person sometime soon. That'll be lovely. So I remember the first time I heard Joni Mitchell was probably Big Yellow Taxi. It was one of those songs that was everywhere for a very long time, but I didn't really know her until about 5 years ago. And people kept asking me if I was very inspired by her and influenced by her, if I'd kind of been listening to her all my life as a kid or whatever, because I apparently sounded like her to the degree that people thought that she influenced me quite a bit. It wasn't until I was traveling in America for about three months back in 2015, and on my own I was backpacking and visiting family, all that kind of thing, and I listened to her album on repeat while I was there on buses and stuff, so listening to that and various things brought about actually The Seduction of Eve, which I was just talking about, was inspired by Josh Ritter, but also listening to Joni Mitchell at that time kind of inspired that song as well. So there was a chain reaction. So I've kind of been clustering my songs into these suites of related stories and that kind of thing. It is a cup of tea, Anne-Marie. It is. I've been very well behaved. I'm on a lovely tablet at the moment called amitriptyline to try and help with my sleep and my random mysterious pains. Anyway. We're just going to have to put up with it. I don't know if anyone else is as much of a stickler for pitch as I am, but that kills me. Just before our love got lost, you
to say. I am as constant as a northern star, and I say, constant in the constant in the darkness. Where is that at? If you want me, I'll be in the bar. On the back of a cartoon coaster, in the blue TV screen light, I drew a map of Canada. Oh, Canada. With your face sketched on it twice. Oh, you're in my blood, you're like holy wine. You taste so bitter and so sweet. Oh, I could drink a case of you, darling, and I would still be on my feet. I would still be on my feet. I'm a lonely painter. I live in a box of paints. I'm frightened by the devil, and I'm drawn to the ones that ain't afraid. I remember the time you told me, you said, love is touching souls. Well, sure, you touch mine, 'cause part of you pours out of me in these lines. From time to time, oh, you're in my blood, you're like holy wine. You taste so bitter and so sweet. Oh, I could drink a case of you, darling, and I would still be on my feet. I would still be on my feet. I met a woman. She had a mouth like yours. She knew your life. She knew your devils and your deeds. And she said, go to him. Stay with him if you can. But be prepared to bleed. Oh, you're in my blood. You're like holy wine. You taste so bitter. Bitter and so sweet. I could drink case of you, darling, and I would still be on my feet. Still be on my, you're in my blood. You're like holy wine. You taste so bitter and so sweet. I could drink a case of you, darling, and I would still be on my feet. I would still be on my feet.
Thanks. I am not functioning tonight, guys. But that was Casey. That was some version of A Case of You by Joni Mitchell. Where are we at in proceedings? Brilliant. I'm going to bring Mick McCullough, aka Son of the Hound, in.
Let's hear it from Michael.
Where's he at? There he is. Hiya, yes, sir.
How's it going?
Not too bad. You look like you've got a halo.
Yeah. I did this for you.
Oh, wow. I'm so privileged.
I feel Christ-like, you know. All style and no substance.
Classic Christ.
That's him. Too flashy for my liking. Mm-hmm. Oh, Christ.
Yeah, that's how they would describe him in most reviews of his work.
I've been having a lovely time listening to you and your fellow guests.
Well, thank you so much. Cheers. For anyone who's not familiar with you, where are you joining us from?
I am joining you from my spare room. I'm just turning the reverb down on my mic there. Is that better?
Yeah.
Yeah. And tell me, is the guitar coming through?
It is.
Cool. I'm joining you from a spare room in Belfast, but I'm from Omagh originally. as you well know, because I bring it up on every conversation that I have with someone that I meet.
and so you should. How long are you in Belfast now?
Came up here when I was 18 for uni, bar a couple of years in between. I've been here ever since. Like,
it's about 2 years, though.
About 2 years, yeah. I'm just going into my final year now, studying medicine. That's okay. Right. I'm going to be a GP.
Wow, that's a terrifying idea. No offense.
No, I know my place in the world. I know that's a terrifying idea. Terrifies me, even the thought of it. I'll probably not sleep tonight, even though I was joking. I'll be thinking about that alternative universe where I was a doctor.
I would not sleep. If I was in that position of trying to fathom a universe where I was a doctor, to be honest, that's...
Yeah. I mean, doctors are grand, but musicians, we're the real heroes, you know? What's the point in being well if you can't enjoy yourself, you know?
You're dead right. You're dead right, Mike. You're dead right, Michael. Our cause is Sera Husky and Animal Rescue. And as I know, dogs are a cause close to your own heart as well.
They are.
You recently acquired one.
We did, from a little staffy, rescued staffy called Maybe. Because of the uncertainty of, well, we didn't know whether or not she was going to be ours. So we decided when we did get her, we'd call her Maybe.
I was just about to ask, where did the name come from? That's very cute. Yeah. Found her, and you were how did she come into your life?
We ran into her. A friend of mine was saying to me the other day, he's like, I want a dog, but I'm a little bit more kind of I'm a little bit more cautious than you. And I was like, no, this wasn't an impromptu thing. I was like, we've always wanted a dog, we've always said that we're going to get a dog. We just ran into this one who was stray, and we had to take it to the vet, and just events conspired that we were now looking after her. And he goes, that's exactly my point. You bumped into a dog on the street and now it's yours. So, but I mean, it felt like fate, you know?
Yeah. I think that is a good way to acquire any family member.
My family have always kind of had strays, both human and animal, kind of around. Like, my family growing up have always kind of taken in strays. So
was your mom like Irene from Home and Away, where like she just fostered everyone?
Yeah, essentially. Yeah, like my front garden when I was growing up was always just full of like the neighborhood skip rats all playing in the garden. I mean, my would just have a vat of spuds on for everybody.
I love it. I love it so much. What have you been getting up to during these increasingly precedented times?
This is my first live stream, would you believe?
What?
Yeah, 12 weeks after everybody else started, I thought I'd get on it. Spent all day today figuring out the software to make that so I could go through Logic and do all this. And I was like, this is brilliant. The endless possibilities. And then I was like, oh yeah, that's right. Lockdown is easing. Everybody's going, is kind of over this. Not over it, but you know what I mean. I was like, I'm 12 weeks behind everybody else. Great timing as usual.
Yeah,
Sorry, go ahead.
Like on the very bleak bright side, gigs are not going to happen again for a long time anyway. Yeah. So
that is a very bleak bright side. I mean, I had no gigs booked anyway, so it doesn't. it just feels like normal service for me. But no, I've been in the spare room. This is my spare room. I know it looks pretty flashy and sexy right now. It's not always this sexy. Trying to write, do a bit of script writing, and trying to do a bit of demoing as well. But it's, you know, it's like when you're kind of housebound, I find a lot of the stuff, like a lot of things that inspire me to write and create stuff, it comes from day-to-day interactions with people. And when that is cut off, then you're kind of like, oh, what'll I write about? What I had for breakfast again? It's always Weetabix. It's always been Weetabix, you know? There's only so many songs you can write about Weetabix. Believe me, I'm trying to write more.
we'll co-write a song about Weetabix, and it'll have both of our varying approaches to it, and mine will be about Limerick Weetabix and yours will be about Oma/Belfast Weetabix, and it'll be really interesting.
Yeah. Are you a Weetabix fan, are you? Not that I can just say I haven't been sponsored by Weetabix on this live stream, although I am open to the prospect.
I'll tag Weetabix in and I'll let them know that you're open to sponsorship. I'd be into Weetabix. I'd be a fan. Yeah, I think
it's a good, lot good sturdy start to the day. Regular as clockwork.
Excellent.
I promised myself I wouldn't do this every time.
I swore I wouldn't talk about poo. Johnny Kelly asks, when is the also, it's in capital letters, when is the also runs season 2 coming out?
When I can afford to pay the director to, and director / editor to do that, because it's not fair for me to ask Colm to put in so many man hours, which he already has done, and he's continuing to do, but I still feel like I would have a guilt on me if he turned around and said, listen, just pay me when you can, because I don't know if I can ever pay him, you know, and I would rather have the thing out and paid for before I put it out, but that's just a personal thing. Maybe it's a hang-up that I need to get over. Some people are way more kind of generous with their kind of expectations of payment when they know that you yourself are kind of in a similar vein. So, Johnny, I don't know, but I would like to think it might be sometime this year.
He says to go fund me that son of a bitch. He doesn't say son of a bitch. Son of a bitch is what he says.
Yeah, so, I should do that. I mean, yeah, I was always really reluctant to do that, to go fund me, because I always thought nobody would. It's like, why? Nobody's going to give me money. But that's just like your own hang up again that I have to get over.
Yeah, I get you though. I do get you. It's hard. For anyone who's tuning in has no idea what we're talking about, Mick writes and stars in a show called Also Rans. It's a web series what even is about? I don't know how to describe it without being insulting. So I'll let you explain.
Be insulting. That's the joke is on us. Like, the joke was, so it was like, I was getting ready to release a song and I was like, fuck, I can't do this cycle again and expect the same or expect different results. That is, isn't that the one of the signs of badness, doing the same thing and expecting a different result? So I was like, I need to try something, and I do script writing as well. I was like, how about I try and combine the two and do like this kind of fictionalized version of myself, like a hyper real or hyper fictionalized version of myself, and take the piss out of the whole process of writing a song and releasing a song and all, like the huge disparity between the expectations and the reality. So the guys, the two characters, Muck and Tony, are completely deluded. They believe this song will just catapult them from zeros to heroes in a matter of, you know, weeks. But as you and I both know, that's not how the music industry works. So it was essentially that there. The fourth episode was probably the one that is closest to reality. It's they go into like a PR company. The PR company keeps talking to them about the brand instead of the band, and their whole head's fried. They think they're in the wrong room and everything. But that was it. It started off as a kind of as a promotional tool, and it just kind of got a life of its own. And
it's
brilliant. I really need
it's a work of brilliance.
Thank you so much. Yeah, I love doing it. It sounds kind of weird and corny, but in a way, it kind of did change my life, because it kind of completely steered it in a different, well, not in a different direction, but I don't know. I wouldn't have been able to sell out the gigs that I sold out or get the response to the music without it. And other things on the writing side really kind of came to fruition after it. So just goes to show, fucking, I was told not to do it because it was a bad idea and it would confuse people. Just goes to show, don't listen to your mates. They don't know what they're talking about.
That is the takeaway from this entire live stream.
Or get better mates.
Or have money.
Yeah, have money is just goes to show, have money.
You're welcome, folks. You're welcome. All right, I'm going to hand the screen over to you to play your song. What song are you going to do first before I do that?
I'm just going to minimize my screen. I am going to play Slip Sliding Away by Paul Simon.
Brilliant.
Because
what
it is the most beautifully hopeless song. And not in a really overt way. I just think it was always the second verse always stuck with me. All the verses are great, but the second verse always stuck with me as like a really poignant hopelessness, but in a really restrained way. And I don't know, I just loved it. And it's always kind of been one of my favorites.
Sounds as good a reason as any. All right. Well, I'm going to hand it over to you all in your lonesome and enjoy.
Cool. Thank you.
slip sliding away, slip sliding away. You know, the nearer your destination, the more you slip sliding away. And I know a man, he came from my hometown. He wore his passion for his woman like a thorny crown. He said, Dolores, I live in fear. My love for you is so overpowering, I'm afraid that I will disappear. Slip sliding away, slip sliding away. You know, the nearer your destination, the more you slip sliding away. And I know a woman became a wife. These are the very words she uses to describe her life. She said, a good day ain't got no rain. She said, a bad day is when I lie in bed and think of things it might have been. Slip sliding away, slip sliding away. You know, the nearer your destination, the more you slip sliding away. And I know a father had a son. He longed to tell him for the reasons of the things he had done. He came a long way just to explain. He kissed his boy as he lay sleeping, then he turned around and headed home again. Slip sliding away, slip sliding away. You know, the nearer your destination, the more you slip sliding away. God only knows, God makes his plan. The information's unavailable to the model man. We work our jobs, collect our pay. Believe we're sliding down the highway, and in fact we're slip sliding away, slip sliding away. You know, the nearer your destination, the more you slip sliding away.
I'm always so tempted to leave people like sitting there in silence for ages after they finish the song. Just like
stood up and just in my jocks. That's me away. Like Paul Simon himself often does.
Famous for it. Famous for it. Mm-hmm. Always bashing people.
Flaunt it when you got it.
This is it. This is it.
Which is why I haven't stood up. I don't got it.
Whatever it is, I haven't it. There was some lovely comments there for you. People
That's nice.
Pat Short said he loved it.
What? The Pat Short?
The Pat Short.
Fuck off. Oh. Sorry. This isn't the BBC. I can square for one.
You can square all you want to.
Thanks, Pat Short.
Lots of people have tuned in and said they really, really enjoy that and are singing along and are being your choir from home, which is really nice. That's what we want. That's what we want to hear.
That's lovely. Thank you very much, everybody.
I can't believe this is your first live stream.
Yeah, I know. I actually really want to. I'm thinking of doing like more. I'm going to do more. I think I'm going to do some music live streams. And I was thinking of doing something like an improv script writing thing where like have, you know, I'll share my screen and have like script writing software up and crowdsource a bit of crack and kind of write it on the fly and have people contribute. I think that might be a laugh as well. But it's just, I just want to try stuff. You know, I know, as I said, I'm about 12 weeks late, but it took me a while to adapt to the whole, the event.
You know, I don't think there's a right time really at the moment, because you know, I've, you know, a lot of people have been feeling like, oh, everyone is doing live streams, I don't want to add to the noise. And then there's a bit of that, and then there's a bit of just it's a lot of effort and energy to put it all together. So yeah, if it's not something you necessarily want to do or are comfortable doing, I'd say just wait until you feel comfortable doing it. And now you're all set up and you might as well make notes of the
I'm very uncomfortable under or without like the noise of a band behind me, because I'm like, wouldn't be the strongest singer, but I make no bones about that. I've been blessed with a voice that lacks any gravitas, but so this is kind of very exposing, but I'm kind of getting over that now, you know. So when I started music, it was always with a band, and it was always like a loud band, so that was kind of like a comfort blanket for all the kind of shortcomings. But that's just kind of something that I need to get over. You know, your own sometimes you can be your own worst enemy with those sort of things,
for sure. And I think of all of my musical for that, you're an awful divil for self-deprecation.
You get there first, but slag yourself off before anybody else can slag you off.
I'm very much in that boat with you on that front. Yeah.
That's how you win or lose. I haven't decided yet. I've been trying to spend my whole adult life trying to figure out if that's a winner's way or a loser's way. That's the conflict.
It kind of depends on the outcome, I suppose, really. Yeah. You can decide after.
It remains to be seen, is what you're saying.
Anyway, you've got a bunch of new fans. A lot of people who thought that was absolutely brilliant, loved your choice of song, and found you very, very entertaining.
Thank you very much, everybody.
If people want to keep in touch with you and see what else you're getting up to and see any of those script writing or songwriting sessions, where can they find you?
I'm mostly active on Twitter and Instagram. Son of Hound on Twitter would be the, I like to fire off an odd smart-arse remark 20 times a day. My music's on Spotify, or if you want to buy it directly or buy any my merch, it's on Bandcamp. But Twitter, Spotify, Facebook, and then there's Mad Notions podcast as well, which I do weekly with our mutual friend Nathan O'Regan.
Yeah, let me see if I have a comment from him here. I definitely had a couple. One of them was Mick said, "Fuck, what a bastard." Another one. He said a nice one. There was a nice one up here somewhere. Oh yeah, fair playness unto you, Michael, is what he said.
Well, and also unto you, my child.
All right, Messiah, I'm gonna let you go.
Cheers, Emma. Thanks a million for organizing this as well. Like, it's, I've said this to you before, but like, your work ethic and your attitude is like a fucking inspiration. So keep on trucking. Honk honk.
Thank you.
Cheers, Emma. Good luck.
Bye. So that was Mick McCullough, also known as Son of the Hound. Go find him on Twitter, on Instagram. His music is on Spotify. He's hilariously funny and a brilliant musician. So do go and support him and enjoy his work. It's recommended as medicine for you all. All right. So by special request from Trina, this is Birds of a Feather by Declan O'Rourke. I wanted to put in something by him, but I wasn't sure which song I was going to do. So this is the song I landed on, thanks to her. So here it is. Just the other day,
We were in love and still joined as one, like two wings on a dove, just you and me, sure of ourselves, sure of anything, as much as anyone else. But we're just two lost, lonely people now. We're just two lost, lonely people now, without a goodbye. The little bird in our hands shot into the night, took off with our plans. Something so good won't go too far, and if we try to be true, it may come back to our hearts. But we're just two lost, lonely people now. We're just two lost, lonely people now. Ever since we tethered, it's been you and me together, and that's just how we got by. 'Cause birds of a feather, they always stick together. So let's brave the weather and fly. Stay with me for a while. Come into the light. Our love is strong. We can win this fight. Something so good won't go too far, and if we try to be true, it may come back to our hearts. It may come back to our hearts. It may come back to our hearts. But we're just two lost, lonely people now. We've just two lost, lonely people now. We've just two lost, lonely people now. We've just two lost, lonely people now.
So that was for Trina. Trina, I hope you didn't cry. Sorry if you did, but thank you for your request. It was a beautiful song. Declan O'Rourke has been a very big part of my life since I was a teenager. My mom introduced me to his work and obviously fell in love with it, as everyone does, because his work is incredible. He's got the most beautiful voice and he's an absolute wordsmith. That song is, it's just a really gorgeous description of that situation you find yourself in, where you're in a relationship and it's falling apart and you just hope you can piece it back together, and you know that you've got something there worth saving. So it's a really gorgeous song for that. Birds of a Feather by Declan O'Rourke. So I'm going to do a song now by Wallace Bird, which is along the same lines. This is You Are Mine. Here it is. Well, you wore your clothes in bed, and the stars came out for miles, sweet and soft and heavy as lead. You roped your arms around me and you smiled. Well, all the strength in the world couldn't hold my tears that night. I held on to you 'cause you were going away, and you just lay there, you didn't even realize. Well, my love, I love you, goodbye, so long, farewell, for a while, goodbye.
And when you come back, will you look for me? I'm serious, 'cause I love you, and you are mine. Well, I've never felt like this. I'm confused and out of style. I fall out with friends, but they stay true. They misguidedly tell me all I do is you. Should you never let me know? Should you ever love me less? Well, I'll hold on to you and you won't go anywhere. And I'll just constantly tell you you're the best. My love, I love you. Goodbye, so long. Farewell for a while. Goodbye. And when you come back, will you marry me? I'm serious, 'cause I love you, and you, you. I love you. Goodbye, so long. Farewell for a while. Goodbye. And when you come back, will you look for me? I'm serious, 'cause I love you, and you are mine.
That's You Are Mine by Wallace Bird. Thanks, guys. Thanks for all your lovely comments. They mean a lot. So I think I'm going to bring in our next guest now. This is the sensational Shane Hennessy. I can't quite remember where I met Shane first, but we have shared stages a few times ever since then. And he has always been mind-blowingly brilliant and extraordinarily lovely. So it's great to have you joining us. Hi, Shane.
Ah, thank you, Emma. I appreciate that. Cheers. I think the first time we met in person was, if I'm not wrong, it was down in UL, and you were doing the panel with Rhiannon Giddens and who else was on that day?
For Women's
Ellie,
Day. So,
Ellie, does the PR, Ellie Byrne, is that her, Ellie O'Brien? I can't remember her name. Yeah. Carl Corcoran organized it. And I went that day because I saw the lineup. I was just like, I want to go to that.
I feel like that was a weird... So it was myself, Karen Casey, Ellie, Rhiannon, Nia Breeden.
Karen Casey, that's who, yeah.
That was an incredible lineup. And I was so annoyed at myself that day because I was... I don't know about you, but for me personally, I have days when I just cannot get in the zone of speaking in front of people. And I was so excited to be there. And I was so aware of like the royalty that I was surrounded by. And I could not kick myself into gear. So I came away from that event just like, ugh, I need to like do something to fix this situation. So
no, I thought it was brilliant that day. Like, cause I think I knew your name, but I hadn't heard you play before. And I remember sitting in the audience and I was texting people. I was like, have you heard of Emma Langford? Oh my God, you need to listen to this girl playing like all these amazing tunes. Cause I remember you were so full of personality that day when you were singing on stage. And I was just like, who is this? I remember looking you up on Instagram, like sitting in the audience in the lecture hall, looking up who's Emma Langford, you know? I think
sitting
from memory,
your sunglasses, that's like, who is
that? Yeah. that Declan O'Rourke song you did was lovely. It actually brought me back to the first time I heard Declan O'Rourke, which was back in 2007 or 8 in Carlow, and said, oh, there's this guy playing in the theatre in town tonight. And I had just broken up with my first girlfriend at the time. I was probably 14 or 15 or whatever age. And dad is like, oh, come on, you know, we'll bring you out some music. So we went to the theatre and it was Declan O'Rourke, you know, and neither of us had ever heard him before. and he had a guy with him named Ari Hest, an amazing singer-songwriter from New York, and the two of us just sat there like, oh my God, how have we never heard this before? So it's interesting you chose that song, because that was the song that stood out to me on the night when he performed it. So it was cool to hear it a couple of minutes ago.
He has a really, really, I mean, as a songwriter, he has this way of reaching into your heart and like finding something that you think is the most personal and specific thing and making it into this beautiful, timeless, universal kind of a story, which is, you know, it's what any songwriter aspires to. And he manages it so seamlessly all of the time. It's disgusting. You are, I mean, from my own perspective, you're probably one of the most kind of virtuosic and brilliant musicians that Ireland has had in a very, very long time and has exported in a very long time. What kind of pushed you towards doing the kind of performance that you do now, and that kind of, I know that you're very inspired and influenced by the likes of Tommy Emmanuel and all that, but what made you want to be that person?
Honestly, I don't know. I mean, I never actually thought I would be a musician. I thought I was going to be a psychologist. That's what I was focused on when I came out of school. I was like, I'm, you know, I play music for fun and I like it and I have an aptitude for it, but I never actually thought that I would start gigging, you know, for a living. I had done it from, I think the first gig I did, not playing traditional music, I did with, I'm sure you know Brian Glynn from Ye Vagabonds. Myself and Brian did a gig together when we were 13 years old. We're both from Carlow. And we played in the rowing club or the boat club in Carlow Town. And I remember, for, you know, we were two 13-year-olds and all these other like 16, 17-year-olds all had bands and they were all playing stuff like... And then we come on in the middle and we're playing like Bert Jansch, you know, and we're playing Mark Knopfler tunes. And all these younger people are like, who the hell are these two kids coming up here playing all this stuff? But their parents were like, oh, this is the stuff, you know. But I never thought that I would do this for a living. You know, I thought when I went to college, it's like, I'll do my psychology degree and then I'll become a psychologist and music will be fun. And I ended up saying yes anytime someone wanted me to do a gig. And then between offers coming in and me enjoying it more and becoming more comfortable on stage, it became gradually more obvious that that's what I wanted to do because I got such a kick out of it. And it just never stopped. I never looked back. I just said, right, I'm going to do this. I'm going to throw my whole self into this, and that's kind of the way it's been since I was about 17.
Wow. And you finished your degree in psychology?
No, I didn't. No. Okay. What happened was I ended up leaving college. I ended up working in a music shop in Dublin for a while. And it was basically because I realized that I didn't want to be a psychologist. Once I was about a year and a half into the course, I realized this is not what I meant to be or what I meant to do. And because the calling for music was becoming stronger all the time, and I was making, you know, I was playing in pubs in Temple Bar, I was doing weddings, I was doing corporate gigs, I was doing whatever I could. And I just thought, I can, you know, if I keep my free time to work on my music, I think I can make a good go of this. And that's what I did. It was kind of a very disciplined way of looking at it. But I thought, if I have to make a go of it, this is what I have to do. And so it just kind of snowballed from there, I suppose.
That's, you know, I feel like when kids come out of school, throwing them into a 4-year degree is insane anyway. And I think doing a year and a half introductory course to something, it just sounds like a much better approach. And it means that if that kind of thing does happen, where you realize a year into your degree that actually, you know, you're starting to meet new people and discover who you are as an adult. So there should be that opportunity there for people to kind of, you know, do that initial one and a half years of whatever they think they might like to do, and then go elsewhere. I think that's probably a better system.
Absolutely, yeah. It's really unusual, even on mainland Europe, to go to college as soon as you finish the equivalent of secondary school and you're 17 or 18. I mean, they have, I suppose, what we might call it like a technical college or like a PLC or something similar to that, but it's a little bit more formalized than that.
Yeah.
Which is optional at the end of their schooling, you know, when they're 16 or 17. And that kind of sets them up then for, you know, which direction do you want to go into? At least you're not going into something blind like we do. You know, you just hope for your CAO points and whatever comes up, that's what you do for 4 years. You know, it's a ridiculous amount of pressure. And it means that people who might like to try something or people who specialize in something have to decide way early on what they want to do in life, which is totally wrong. I mean, yeah. I don't know, had I been in school and thought I want to be a musician, you know, what are the options for me? Do I want to go to a college and study music theory? maybe not. I don't know. I knew I wanted to, you know, I liked the idea of performing, but the idea of going to like a performing college to be a musician doesn't particularly, you know, like it exists in the kind of the guise of like BIM, that kind of thing, which I think does a great job setting people up to be kind of all round musicians. But to actually get into performing and like the kind of the social networks you need to kind of, you know, get yourself involved in, and then kind of thinking about yourself not just as a musician but as like a little business as well, it's nothing really prepares you for that, and you know that as well as I do, as just kind of laying yourself into it and going, crap, this is all the stuff I need to do today, how am I going to get it all done, you know? But I think, and I think it was Mick that said it earlier, but I have to agree with him as well, that I've always been so impressed with your work ethic and the way that you organize people, the way that you stand up for people's rights, the way that you stand up for campaigns that are actually going to make a difference. And it's, there aren't a lot of artists out there who have the balls to do that, to actually stand up and say, this is what I believe in. I'm not just going to be one of these cookie cutter people. I'm actually going to stand up and say what I think. And that's how I'm going to, you know, I'm going to be me as a person rather than just trying to please everybody. And I think that's something that you have. That's just part of you. It's an inherent part of you that has to be commended. And I wish more people were like that. I wish more artists were like that, because I've always been really impressed and inspired by that in you.
Thank you so much. I am very much the cliche Irish person in that I'm terrible at taking compliments, but I really appreciate it. And it means a lot coming from you, because I really, really admire your own work and your work ethic as well. I'm going to hand the screen over to you to perform your song. What song did you choose for us, and why did you kind of choose that one?
I was going to do a song by Steely Dan, but I actually changed my mind in the time between talking to you earlier, and I'm going to do something a little bit different. This is a song that I've been having a little bit of fun with over the past year and a half or so. And I started doing it in my live set because... long story short, I was called for an encore one night and I had nothing. I'd played my entire set and it was it's a venue I've been to loads of times in Germany. And so I was kind of familiar with the audience and I'd played everything I thought I could play. And there were, you know, one more tune. And the promoter said to me, go on, one more. And I was kind of thinking, crap, I've given them everything. What do I do? So the one song that came into my head from my Temple Bar gigging days was You Can Call Me Al by Paul Simon. And it's a song I've always loved, right? So I just thought, right, I used to play this just for fun in the bars. And the thing was, I had figured out at the time how to do the parts of the song on my own on the guitar. So that's kind of what I thought, right, this will suit a guitar audience. And that I'd have like the keyboard or the horn part that... Okay, I'll get that going. And then I can keep the backbeat going. And then I can bring in the bass. And then I got to, oh crap, I have to remember all the words because that song has about 3,000 words in it. So what I used to do in the shows was I would divide the audiences between the left-hand side and the audience or the right-hand side. And I'd say, right, the left-hand side, I want you to sing one line and I want the right-hand side to sing another line. But since... you know, because we're doing all this virtually now, I'm not people to sing lines back to me. So in my own live streams, I've been asking people to write the parts in the comments instead. So I'm going to try this tonight and see if it works in the comments. Okay, so we're going to split this right down the middle of the alphabet. If your surname begins, you know, between A to L or something like that, or A to K, right, you get part number one. Right? And I'll tell you what part number one is. Part number one is, ooh, spell that any way you like. Just a letter O, mash the letter O, zeros, whatever you want, okay? Zeros or O's, go for it, okay? Part number two, surnames from M downwards, okay? Part number two is mbap, okay? That's what I usually say to the audience. So whatever way you think spelling mbap sounds to you, write that in the comments as well. And about halfway through the song, I'm going to get all of you to write in your parts as I'm singing them. So your comment section is about to turn into a mess, Emma. I'm really sorry.
I'm so excited.
It'll be a bit of fun. As I said, surnames A to L, you get ooh. And then surnames M down to Z. Or if you have a surname with a number or a hieroglyphic or something in it, you know, pick whichever one feels good to you. All right, so we'll do a little bit of You Can Call Me Al by Paul Simon. Walks down the street, says, why am I soft in the middle now? Why am I soft in the middle now? The rest of my life so hard. I need a photo opportunity, I need a shot of redemption. Though I'd end up a cartoon in a cartoon graveyard. Like Bone Digger, Bone Digger, dogs in the moonlight. Far away, my yell is so clear. Just a beer belly, beer belly. Get these mutts away from me, I said. I don't find this stuff amusing anymore. If you be my bodyguard, I can be your long-lost pal. I can call you Betty, and Betty, when you call me, you can call me Al. Man walks down street and says, why am I short of attention? Got a short little span of attention, all my nights are so long. Where's my wife and family? What if I die here? Who'll be my role model now that my role model's gone? She's gone. He ducked back down the alleyway with some roly-poly little bat-faced girl. And all along, there were incidents and accidents. There were hints and allegations. Cause if you'll be my bodyguard, I can be your long-lost pal. I can call you Betty. Yeah, Betty, when you call me, you can call me Al. All right, folks, this is where the audience participation starts. As I said earlier on, during my live shows, I usually get people to sing these back to me. But all we've got is the comments. So surnames A to L, I want you to write this in. And I want you to be creative, whatever way you feel conveys that the best. I want you to write that into a comment right now. Ooh, ooh, ooh. Right, surnames M to Z. I want you to write this. Mm-ba, mm-ba. Mm-ba, mm-ba. Okay, whatever way you feel mbop should look like in text, that's what I want you to write in right now. Okay, so part one. Part two. And I want you to keep it going as well, because during my live shows I get the people to keep singing this back to me until the tune finishes. So I want you to do the same. I want you to write the comments in until the tune ends, right? One, two, one, two, three. If you be my bodyguard, I can be your long lost pal. I can call you Betty. Yeah, Betty, when you call, you can call me Al. Said if you be my bodyguard, I can be your long lost pal. I can call you Betty. Yeah, Betty, when you call me, you can call me Al. You Can Call Me Al by Paul Simon from Graceland.
Sorry, I was really reluctant to jump back in there because I didn't want it to end.
I can't see the comments here where I'm sitting at the moment. Are people joining in?
Yeah.
Good, good. The first time I did that on a live stream, I was doing my album launch. I launched an album called Rain Dance about a month ago, and I did it on a live stream. It was one of those Culture Ireland perform streams, and I came up with the idea there and then. I just said, everybody write it into the comments, and I couldn't finish the song because I was laughing so much, because all these people who usually write these serious, thoughtful comments were just all of a sudden, ooh, ah, ooh, ooh. And then the comments came in from the replay, and the people on the replay were like, why the hell are people like that I know writing just ooh in the comments everywhere? I hope that happens. I hope someone looks back at this tomorrow and sees the timestamp of like 2 hours. Like, why did everyone just like start mashing their keyboards around then?
Collective hysteria. Yeah, no, that was hilarious. It's amazing. Oh, I love it so much. That's genius. I'm going to, right, while I have everyone in the comments, I'm going to put the second PayPal link. Right. Now that you're all paying attention. Okay, that was feckin' amazing. If people want to go check out your album and support you and all that, where should they go? What should they do?
Yeah, so I'm on all the usual social media places, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, YouTube, blah, blah, blah. Shane Hennessy Music everywhere. You'll find me. And then shanehennessy.ie is the website. So if you're going to get music, get it from my website. Best place to get it rather than giving Spotify or Amazon or anybody else the cold hard cash, go straight to the website and buy it instead. But yeah, you'll find me everywhere under just the name Shane Hennessy. I think I'm still the most popular Shane Hennessy. There was an actor in California who was trying really hard. I mean, like really hard. But I think I still haven't beaten, you know. And a public apology as well. There's a Shane Hennessy in Rathfarnham who was a brilliant musician. And I used to live down the road from him. We lived on the same road. And I think that he has changed his name recently to I think Shane Stephen Music, because I think he must have been getting jumbled up with me, unfortunately. So apologies to the other Shane Hennessy in Rathfarnham.
You edged the competition out. I like it.
Yeah. It's not a title you ever really want to win, though, is it? Like, if you had an Emma Langford living down the road who was a great musician as well, you'd feel kind of shit about it, you know. Yeah. Sorry, you know.
There's an Emma Langford who's a very famous musician, an incredible musician. She's a vocalist, and she does a song called Is It 'Cause I'm Cool with a band called Moose Tea.
All right, okay.
I think she might also be the vocalist on, remember that song from when we were kids, the I'm Horny song?
Oh, yeah, yeah. I'm horny, horny.
Yeah, she's the vocalist on that.
Wow, Emma Langford.
Yeah, so I often get emails and messages to my Facebook page looking for me to sing at club nights and stuff.
You should take them onto her. You should absolutely take them and just say nothing. Just show up with your guitar being like, you booked me.
We've been talking for a while about swapping places at some point, where she takes one of my bookings and I take one of hers.
Can you imagine that Milwaukee Irish Fest next year?
I'll just get her set list and I'll start doing her songs.
But
no, what happened was we were kind of mixed up a couple of times between different things. And what wound up happening was she actually liked my page, followed me on Twitter, and she joined the crowd supporting thing for my first EP. She
deadly. She good on her. Fair play to her.
She's a lovely, lovely girl.
Ah, that's deadly. I just get mistaken for any other name other than Shane Hennessy. It's such an easy name to mess up, unfortunately. Half the world calls me Sean, so I answer to Sean now, and then no one can spell Hennessy. It's like two N's, two S's, three E's, you know, four E's, one N, one S, you know. I got called Sharon once on a building. There's a place there's a place in Dublin, honest to God, I don't know how they did it. There's a place in Dublin that I used to gig in called, it's now called Sweetman's, but it used to be called Messrs. Maguire's. It's on O'Connell Street Bridge. And I used to gig up there on like a Tuesday night. And they said they wanted to start billing all the acts that were playing there. So I said, they said, what do you want to put down? I just said, put Shane Hennessy and Friends, because it was just whoever was around, I'd ring up and say, I want a gig tonight. And it ended up one night anyway, going up, and I walked up to the front door and it said, live music tonight by Sharon Hussey. And I was like, come on. So I took a picture of myself as like live tonight. And there's still a part of me wonders, is there a Sharon Hussey out there who gigs, and is it just a big mix up? Because it could be.
Yeah.
You know? So
I love it. You took
We'll find out someday.
Absolutely. Sharon, are you out there? Let us know.
Sharon, if you're out there, I've been telling the story about you for years.
I love it. Brilliant. Shane, thank you so much for an amazing segment. That was really good fun.
Oh, thank you for having me on.
Looking forward to sharing a stage sometime in the near future.
Yeah, probably next year at this stage. But
this stage, unfortunately,
we'll stay positive.
Yeah, that's the way to be. Yeah. All right, mind yourself, Shane.
All right, thanks for having me on, Emma. I'll see you soon.
Bye. What a gent. All right, so I've got a couple of songs for you, and then I'm going to bring in our last guest, and then I'm going to wrap things up. So what was I going to do? Oh, yes. So this is a song by Foy Vance. A really huge, huge thanks to our guests tonight. We had Miriam Donohue, we had Leslie Dowdall, we had Mick McCullough, aka Son of the Hound. We just had Shane Hennessy, aka Sharon Hussey, there joining us for a tune. And we're going to have Tracy Bruen joining us as well very shortly. Tonight's theme was Our Favourite Songwriters, which was a wide open theme, could be really anything. And everyone picked some really lovely songs. And our cause is Sera Husky and Animal Rescue. Hopefully we've hit our target. If not, get that PayPal link into the comments. Give people a nudge. We just ask that people give kind of a minimum donation of £4 in thanks to our artists and in support of the whole thing, I suppose. So this is Guiding Light by Boy Vance. As I mentioned, my tuner is not working on my guitar, so apologies if it sounds a bit off. So off. I can't do it.
Well, the road is wide, waters run on either side, my shadow in the fading light, stretching out towards the night. Well, the sun is low, and I yet have still so far to go. My lonely heart is beating so tired of the wander. But there's a sign ahead, and I think it's the same one again. I'm thinking about my only friend, and so I find my way home. When I need to get home, you're my guiding light, you're my guiding light. When to get home, you're my guiding light, you're my guiding light. Well, the air is cold, yonder lies my sleeping soul, by the branches broke like bones. This weakened tree no longer holds. Ah, but the night is still, and I have not yet lost my way. Though I will keep on moving until I find my way home. guiding light. You're my guiding light. When I need to get home, you're my guiding light. You're my guiding light. When I need to get home, you're my guiding light. You're my guiding light. So lead me on and lead me strong, like the road I walk on. When I need to get home, you're my guiding light. You're my guiding light. When I need to get home, you're my guiding light. You're my guiding light. To get home, you're my guiding light. You're my guiding light.
That was Guiding Light by Four Vance. Look at your phone. This one. This one. Nope, this one. There we go. All right, so I'm going to introduce our final guest of the night. I am so delighted that this lady agreed to be part of this sing-song. She's been hosting open mics. She's based in Galway, and she is working in a kind of a community outreach capacity, bringing people on board and getting them singing songs and being part of a community through online connections, which is something that a lot of us are missing. I, for one, I'm very good at being in my own company and staying at home, and I don't mind too much, but a lot of people need company and need their community around them to feel whole and to feel okay. And Tracy is doing a really beautiful job of bringing people together through music. So thank you to Tracy Bruen for that and for joining us tonight. Hello, Mrs.
Hiya, how are you, Emma? Thank you for the lovely intro.
I'm not too bad. Sure, look, it's only the truth. Really, really lovely to have you here tonight. You're looking gorgeous.
Stop, Sherry. I put makeup on for the first time in about 3 weeks. That's for you, girl.
I'm chuffed. I'm so chuffed. I've been watching, I suppose, the progression of various people's live streams and how they've evolved. And from, you know, from the first week of lockdown when we all knew, right, we're going to have to figure out ways of doing this, mm-hmm. to where everyone is now. How have you found that journey? Because I know that you've had a real, similar to myself, a real technology journey.
Yeah, in a massive way. I suppose, like, I mean, I would have had a bare idea of, like, what my gear does. But, like, the weekend that lockdown happened, I started thinking about the open mic that I host in the Roisin. And I was like, oh, God, I have to do something. And I announced on the internet that I was going to keep the open mic going and run it. And that was on Saturday, and the open mic was supposed to be on Sunday. And I had no idea how I was going to do that. Like, I had none of the equipment necessary to do that. Classic me. But anyway, a load of people kind of banded together and helped me figure out what I actually had in my house, like an interface. Like, I didn't have a fucking clue what an interface did before the lockdown. And I basically, yeah, got it up and running. And now we run the open mic every Sunday on the Roisin page. And we do it as a kind of a Zoom conference call and stream that call.
So I presume everyone that's joining in then would have their own, I mean, not everyone joining in has that interface or has a mic or has technology or stuff. So people who are joining in to sing along are using their phones or using whatever they have.
No, to be honest with you, we realized pretty quickly that you would need at the very least a laptop, because Zoom condenses the sound so drastically. It's set up for conference calls. It's not set up for musicians. Yeah. But the format that I want to do is that we all talk with each other between the songs. So all the musicians are present. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So Zoom is the only format for that right now, so that we have like 8 musicians all on screen at the same time. So pretty much everyone that plays, well, they first of all, they'd have to be a regular of the open mic anyway, and then they generally have a decent sound setup. So a lot of them have gone through the same journey, starting off with nothing and figuring it out as they've gone on. And so yeah, most people now that are playing it would have an interface at least, right. And you know, that's how they set up going.
That's brilliant. And it's great that, I suppose, in a way, it is good that everyone has to have that set up, because it's pushing everyone to kind of move along at the same pace and everyone's learning together. I'd say you're almost in a position at this stage to give workshops on how to set up for home streaming.
I'd have a fairly solid understanding of the basics anyway. But like, you know, we would have musicians that join us that are looping and are at a whole other level in terms of their ability to manage their equipment. So I mean, at a basic level, yeah, I'll be able to tell you exactly what you need, but like, you know, I ain't no maestro.
You're doing a damn good job of it.
Emma, as are you, girl, like, keeping her lit, good woman.
Look, it's for my own sanity as much as anything else.
I hear that.
It raises a lot of questions, I suppose, this whole thing around festivals going forward and gig bookings, that kind of thing. How much can be... I know that obviously nothing is ever going to be as good as getting a musician live on stage.
Yeah.
This idea of being able to broadcast someone into a festival if they can't be there physically, or, you know, just the options that are available now, even bringing the festival to people in their homes, you know, and that idea that musicians are now set up to be able to share their music with people around the world. There's a gorgeous kind of a side to that as well.
There is, look, definitely. There's positives to it. And like, we have people tuning in from all over the world on, as I'm sure you do here, on Sunday nights, and people who would have left Galway and still have the open mic in their hearts that can tune in and can play. We have some old regulars that can play as well now, you know, because even though they've left Galway. So like, there is always benefits and positives. You just have to find them.
Yeah, absolutely. That's really beautiful. That's so lovely. I know that going forward, I think I'll probably keep the sing song going maybe on a monthly basis, even once restrictions lift, just from that point of view of reaching people around the world, introducing musicians such as yourself to people who haven't heard of you before, and being able to reach people who maybe are housebound for whatever reason, or
I think that's a great idea, and I think that like it has brought something new, you know, and we've gotten that feedback as well from the open mic, that there are people who for various reasons are unable to come to gigs, you know. So like, it's an inclusive medium.
It really is. It's gorgeous. You obviously are, I mean, everyone I've asked to play tonight for this particular theme is a songwriter in their own right. And you've got some absolutely amazing stuff out. You released some new music very recently.
Yeah.
Is that part of a new album?
It is part of the new album that's being started. I always do this. I'm like, you're supposed to have a plan. Like, you know, you're supposed to have the album recorded and the singles already lined up. I'm like, oh my God, I've been sitting on this song for ages. I'm dying to get it out. So I'm just going to get it out. And then I'm going to record the next single. And I'm going to put that out. And then I'm going to record the next single. And while I'm doing that, I'll get the whole album together. And then the bloody lockdown happens. And you don't have an album, but you do have that one single that you released. And 3/4 of another single that was supposed to be released in April.
Yeah, I give a very good impression of someone who has a plan and a structure to what I'm doing.
You do, Emma, because I'm also like, what's Emma's plan? Go on, tell me now.
There's no plan, I just let things happen. My career kind of falls out of the sky in weird little downpours. So if people want to support you and hear more of your music, and they will do once they've heard you singing, because you're feckin' amazing. And I was saying it earlier when I heard Leslie Dowdall for the first time when I was putting together that Spotify playlist.
Mm.
And instantly I connected your voice with her voice. Her, when she was in Intua Nua and doing her thing, I just hear a really strong connection between two very strong, distinctive female vocals, which is really interesting. Yeah. Stuff would you've listened to kind of growing up, or what kind of stuff drew you towards how you wound up sounding and writing?
Well, funny you should ask. No, I've just done a podcast on, I've never done a podcast before, and I'm very aware that, like, you know, everybody's doing podcasts now, but I was asked to do this podcast by notbad.ie, where it's a Galway new musical collective. Anyways, a lot of it was on this question of, like, what are the songs and the artists that inspired me? And I didn't put it into the podcast because I was trying to be cool, but, like, I'll say it here now, like, obviously there's anybody who would know my music would be like, that girl listened to an awful lot of musical theatre. So there was that. Kate Bush is a huge influence. And Fiona Apple would be a massive influence on me as well. And you were singing the Divine Comedy earlier, and the Divine Comedy, absolutely huge influence as well on the way I write and my style.
Right. I would definitely hear musical theatre, and I'm the very same. I kind of grew up listening to the music of the musicals. So it's always in my head, that kind of grand arrangement around stuff, which is, it's hard to get away from.
It is. It gets in there. And, like, I tried to kind of just, you know, not talk about the fact that I spent, you know, 12 years of my life singing along to musicals at any opportunity when I was a child. But you can't get away from it. As you said, I think you're spot on. Once you get that sense of what a big arrangement can sound like, it's hard to let that go. And if I look at, like, you know, the Divine Comedy, Kate Bush, Fiona Apple, it's all about that huge arrangement, you know. So obviously they were linking in with each other in some way, you know.
Yeah. And then I think when you've done that, and you've, from my experience anyways, when you've done that, you've toured the stuff, you've played it with the full band, then when you retrospectively pair it all back to just you and the instrument, you can kind of find new ways of playing it. And it, for me, coming away from all that then and playing a song on my own solo, and being able to change the key or change how it moves, kind of gives it its own kind of freedom and turns it into a different thing entirely again, which is super fun, I find. I used to hate it on my own because I loved the big sound, and then I realized there's a different energy to just standing there yourself, your voice, your person, your instrument. There's a magic to that as well.
And, like, so, like, you would have, no more than myself, started kind of doing a lot solo and then gathered a band around you kind of organically. Do you find it scary when you've been used to playing with your bandmates for a while to go back and do that solo thing, or do you relish it?
It depends on the context. If it's a massive audience, you know, if it's a big event or whatever, I find it quite daunting to stand up there on my own, but there's also a real power to it.
Oh, big time, yeah.
So it fluctuates, and it depends from day to day. I was only saying to Shane there, I have days where I just find it so hard to just kick myself into gear. The switch doesn't flick, and I find it hard to kind of to feel the room and to feel where I am. So that can be challenging. But I don't know. I don't think I have a fear of being on my own on stage anymore. I just maybe enjoy having people to bounce off on stage. And if I can't get that momentum up myself, that there's someone else there next to me who's able to
stuff,
you know?
That's a really good point.
The song you decided to do for us tonight is Gillian Welch's Elvis Presley Blues.
You know it. You literally do, because I've been singing it for years.
It's such a good song. I have such fond memories of myself, Christoph, the Bluebirds, playing that at the Roisin upstairs. It was so much fun.
Many moons ago now.
And that was my first encounter with Gillian Welch's music, and I've come across her a few times since, and her stuff is just incredible. How did you come across her, or what drew you to her work?
I couldn't tell you who introduced me to Gillian Welch first, but I found the album that this song is off, time or the Revelator 12 or 13 years ago easily. And I was just completely and utterly sucked in by it. And it's funny because I don't really write hugely in an Americana style myself. I would have a few songs that have a bit of a country groove to it, but a lot of the music that I listen to and when I'm playing in my covers band, it's all Americana country music. I'm really drawn to that genre as well, and bluegrassy stuff. But she just has so much, she's so much soul in her songs. Like, they tell a story.
I'm trying to remember what the song was that I came across recently, and it felt like she had written it. Oh, I need to find it for you. It felt like she'd written it just before this lockdown. It was insane.
Yeah.
I sent it to my friend Peter. I have it here, definitely. Oh, what was it called? And the lyrics are all about how we don't need to go out and play a song on the road anymore, that we've, you know, we can just sit at home and everything we do is for free these days.
Oh, everything is free now.
Yes, yes.
What do you say? Yeah, that's on the same album, Revelator. It's about 10 minutes long.
Mm.
It is, like, that's a song that just brings tears to my eyes on a regular basis.
Yeah. It's incredible. She's an astonishing songwriter. And I can see why, I mean, you know, as a genre, Americana and country can have its moments. But I think that the good songwriters, the likes of Josh Ritter and Gillian Welch, have a way of, there's an energy to the music and there's a kind of a spirit to the lyrics, a spirituality almost to the lyrics, that is quite unique. Quite unique to the genre, and I can see why you'd be drawn to it as a songwriter and as a performer. So without too much more waffling, I'm going to hand it over to you to share that song with everyone, and we'll chat again after for a couple of minutes.
Love it.
Thanks
Emma. So this is called Elvis Presley Blues. This has been really, really lovely, Emma. Thank you for having me on. It's such an honour. It really is. And you're doing mighty stuff. Okay.
Shook it like it hungry.
roll up, baby, with this song. Let's stay, so let's stay. I was thinking that night about illness, day that he died, day that he died. I was thinking that night about Elvis, day that he died, day that he died. He was all alone in a long, dear climb, thinking how happy John Henry was when he fell down, died. And he shook it and it rang like silver. He shook it and it shined like gold. He shook it and it beat back steam drip, baby. Well, it blessed my soul, blessed my soul. He shook it and it beat that steam drip, baby. Well, it blessed my soul. What's wrong with me? I was thinking that night about Elvis, day that he died, day that he died. I was thinking that night about Elvis, day that he died, day that he died. Just a country boy, combed his hair, put on a shirt his mother made, and went on the air. And he shook it like a chorus girl. He shook it like a Harlem queen. He shook it like a midnight rambler, baby, like you never seen, never seen. He shook it like a midnight rambler, baby, like you never seen,
never see. Yeah, buddy.
Thanks, girl.
That was savage. And a lot of people, I don't know if you can see the comments there, but people
I just have my phone on.
People are just shouting and saying they're definitely going to look up that song. And that they're now in love with it and all that kind of stuff, which is what, when you're doing a rendition of a song that's not your own, that's what you want to achieve, really. So you've beckon nailed it, is what I'm saying.
Great. Well, thank you very much, guys.
Nicely done. Tracy, thank you so much for being part of tonight.
It's my pleasure.
Where can people go to support you and to check out more of your work?
Bandcamp. It's all about Bandcamp. A lot of people are asking that these days about all our artists, and they are the most equitable distributor of music for musicians. It's great and everything to get the streams on Spotify and all of that, but if you actually want to pay a musician for their music, go on to their Bandcamp page. So I have a Bandcamp page, and my album is there, and you can download it or purchase it on CD.
A real life physical CD that you can have, yeah, in hand.
And you can download my last single as well there if you would like. But you know, yeah, so that's it really. Follow me page.
Philip Cashin asks if there are open mic details available, but I presume that's just down to a closed group within the Roisin Dove itself, is it?
Yeah. If he wants to go over to the open mic at the Roisin Facebook page, he can drop me a message there through the Facebook page.
Perfect. So it's the Roisin Dove for anyone looking for those details. Yeah. I'll just wait a sec.
the live show tends to be just regulars, because it puts, there's a lot of work that goes into putting it out. So we kind of just work with the people that we kind of know, but there are other ways of getting involved. So he should drop us a line anyway.
Brilliant. Well, I'll pass it on to him. Thank you so much, Tracy. You've been an absolute treat and a delight to have us part of tonight.
Thank you for having me.
We'll get to share a stage together very soon.
Fingers crossed.
Mind yourself.
Bye. See you. Slum.
The brilliant Tracy Bruen. She is a phenomenal artist, as you saw there, and a lovely, lovely lady. Brilliant songwriter. Go and check her out. I can't recommend her enough to you. She's absolutely fabulous. Thank you all for tuning in, for commenting. Thank you to everyone who's chipped into the PayPal so far. All of that money is being divided between our artists. Make sure they get paid. And it's going to a very good cause, Sera Husky and Animal Rescue in County Kerry. They are a small independent animal rescue that are working so hard, tirelessly at the moment, to save abandoned or neglected animals. They're working really, really hard. It's heartbreaking, really, to see the kind of stuff that they have to come up against. And as an animal lover, I'm so grateful to them for doing it. I'm going to play you a couple more songs. I've got a couple of my own songs. I've got a song by the Beatles. I've got a song by Ron Sexsmith. There was a request for my song, The Unbearable Lightness of Being, so I'm going to play that for you. And I'm going to play a couple of songs off my new album, which you might not have heard before. So the first song I'm going to play for you is Demon Darling. And Demon Darling is one off my new album, as I mentioned. That night I watched as you gave in to vanity and loneliness, and all your very thoughts of him, and darkness overcame you as he tangled up in sheets. Oh, what a tangled web you weave. You're so practiced in deceit. You've got a demon learning. It's hungry for the kill, and if you don't slay her, perhaps you never will, you never will. Followed her out of the dark to where your eyes could meet, and danced to music in your head. Toe to toe you shared a beat, so easily you drifted into some adopted dream where nothing else existed out beyond your blinding streetlight beam. You've got a demon, darling. It's hungry for the kill, and though if you don't slay it now, perhaps you never will. You never will. Yeah, you never will. You never will. When he awoke, he'd left you with the love he'd left behind, and an old crunch around your wrist. All he'd left is your mind. When he awoke, he'd left you with the love he'd left behind, and an old crunch around your wrist. All he'd left is your mind. You've got a demon, darling. It's hungry for the kill. Oh, if you don't say no, perhaps you never will. You've got a demon, darling. It's hungry for the kill. Oh, if you don't say no,
Perhaps you never will, you never will. Yeah, you never will. You never will.
That's Demon Darling. So I'm going to play you guys The Unbearable Lightness of Being, which is my own song. I haven't played it in a really long time, so I apologize in advance if I forget any of the words. I'm going to just put this comment up on the screen just because. So to have a reminder. Have any of you seen this song played live? I usually play it with some accompanying musicians. So my own band usually consists of a drummer, a cellist, a violinist, or two. Bassist. Usually a host of musicians around me to play the song, but I'm going to do my best to play a solo version of it. The song is inspired by the book The Unbearable Lightness of Being by Milan Kundera, and it's quite a sad book. Put your hand up in the comments if you've read it. It's an exploration of the kind of the choices we make in life, whether we want to be the creative, liberal spirit, the person that has no kind of ties and figurative or literal, kind of person that is at every protest and wants to see a kind of a liberal society thriving where everything is free and nobody's tied down to anything. And then there's that's the lightness. And then there's the heaviness, which is the kind of allowing yourself to be tied down to things, allowing yourself to be grounded. It's kind of the book explores those choices we make in life. Which one do you choose, you know? And so I found it really a really interesting book to read as an artist. You know, you're expected to always be the light, always be the lighter one, the person who's super floaty and liberal and free-spirited, but that can be hard. When you have to be a businesswoman as well. Sorry, tuning. think I'll get away with that name. But yeah, it's it was an interesting book to read. And it explores those things within the context of being in a relationship and the choice you make to be, I suppose, the main character of the book kind of would probably be wanting to be polyamorous and... But he's with women who don't want that. that can be challenging, I'd imagine. So anyway, this is from the point of view of the two women who are the leading women in the book. The main character's wife and the main character's mistress. Oh, my darling man, would you ask me to dance once more? Take my hands in your hands once more. Oh, my only dear, would you take me away from here? Would you help me abate my fears? I have dreams of a cottage by the shore. I have dreams, such dreams, so vivid, they're real in my mind. But to lay with you is all I can do just to find the unbearable lightness of being, the unbearable lightness of being, the unbearable lightness of being, of being, of being. To lay by you is all I can do just to find the unbearable lightness of being, the unbearable lightness of being, the unbearable lightness of being, of being, of being. So that was The Unbearable Lightness of Being, which is from my first album, Quiet Giant. Thank you for tuning in and for commenting. Some lovely comments there. Hi, Brian. Thanks for tuning in. Anne-Marie says, polyamorous or ambidextrous. I love the idea of exploring the space between lightness, liberal ideas, and a more grounded earth presence. Yeah, I think everything is very nuanced, and we have to be very aware of that. We can't pigeonhole ourselves. I'm going to play you guys another one of my own songs. And then I'm going to wrap up with wrap up with the Beatles, I think. This is The Seduction of Eve. Ugh, sorry, the guitar's really out of tune, it's really bugging me. Seduction of Eve. The reason I want to do this one is because I was doing a really lovely event during the week about storytelling. I think it was Evan Davis commented saying that Seduction of Eve is one that he would always be curious about the backstory to. So I wrote it when I was traveling in America way back when, 5 years ago. And I was listening to The Seduction or The Temptation of Adam by Josh Ritter. And I was listening to Joni Mitchell and they had a lovely music baby in my head. And and I was going through a bad breakup at the time as well. So this song kind of just sort of just came out of all of that. The ideas in the song are this kind of picture, this image of someone who's, and the music video goes along with this as well. This idea that you when you get into a relationship with someone, you give them your trust and however that relationship ends, when it ends, it can feel like a betrayal. Especially if, you know, when you get into a relationship with someone, it can feel like a pact to stick together. And if you don't, it can feel like you've been let down. So at the time of writing Seduction of Eve, that's how I was feeling. Betrayed and let down. And so the song paints that image of someone who's been told by someone that they're going to be with them forever, or stand by them or protect them or whatever. And then they don't. And the character in the song, she's kind of, she feels double crossed. And this song is from her perspective. Mm-hmm.
first night in a drunken haze, we got lost in the crowds. Two spies beyond the other's lines invading. You promised to be on my side, you swore your life for mine. My insurance as I watched my bulwark fading. And I surrendered all too quickly to a man of many names who had plotted excavations where my thoughts were. And I wondered now and then if things would ever be the same, or if anything remained beyond the water. We sat upon a fallen tree one sunny afternoon, side by side, silently surveying a patch of no man's land, and gazing at the wreckage, said the world wind up soon. And the thoughts of my lost brothers he made silent with his hands. And I surrendered all too quickly to a man of many names who had held me ever since I can remember. And I wondered now and then if I would ever feel the same, or vanish onward with the seasons come December. I asked you once in confidence to never leave me be, and you made me swear I knew us to be better than my every self-destructive fear, my insecurities. And we shook on that and turned and watched the weather change. And I surrendered all too quickly to a man of many names who had held me ever since I can remember. And I wondered now and then if I would ever feel the same, or vanish onward with the seasons come December. So I wonder, did you ever really care that much for me? Was it all another epic you've been writing? Another chapter to write down and then scratch out before they see the heart beneath the hearty book they're hiding. So I don't care that much these days for who it is that you became. I never held him, so I hold him no ill feeling. But I wonder now and then if things just might have been the same, if I were happy never to break that last ceiling. And I don't mind, no, I don't mind. I'm just trying to find my peace of mind.
So that was The Seduction of Eve, which is one of my own songs. Thank you for tuning in, for listening, and for asking to hear the songs you want to hear. Lovely to have you involved. And a gorgeous comment there from Trina saying, it really feels as if I've been transported from my sitting room this evening to a land where only gorgeous music, kindness, and a sense of community exists. Bliss, thanks so much. Oh, thanks, Trina. delighted to hear that. Yeah, no, there's a line at the end of Seduction of Eve there, which I... You write a song in a certain state of mind and, you know, you feel a certain way to think about things, and then you might look back and not feel the same way anymore. But there's a line there. So I wonder, did you ever really care that much for me? Was it all another epic you were writing? And for me, that was me drawing in possibly the experiences that I've had where I've broken up with people. And you can't help but feel, you can't help but ask at the end of a relationship, did they ever really care about me? You know, how could they possibly want to hurt me if they cared about me? And that line for me is particularly poignant as a songwriter. That feeling of, was I someone you cared about, or was I a conquest? Was I fodder for another song? Was I fodder for your next story? You know, so that for me is always a poignant line. This is a song by Ron Sexsmith called Strawberry Blonde. She was not the girl next door, but the girl from round the corner. Sat the tail end of grade four when she came to school one morning. All eyes were upon her as she took her seat. Her name was Amanda, pretty eyes of green and hair of blonde, strawberry blonde. Springtime and dandelions and summer round the corner. At the tail end of age nine with a million dreams before her. She lived with her mother in an old decrepit house. If there was trouble at home, she kept it to herself all summer long. Strawberry blonde. And by her face there was no way to tell. It seemed like all was well in her world. But the neighbors said the mother had lost her will to gin and sleeping pills. It was no life for a little girl. Still I see her face framed in blue sky at the top of a slide coming down. And when the sirens wailed, her mother had failed to rise. All the neighbors stood outside as Amanda. She stared at the ground. Time flies and years are piled. I'd forgotten all about her. When I saw her down the aisle of a streetcar with her daughter. Then I heard Amanda say as she got up, "Come on, Samantha. Girl, this is our stop." And they were gone. Two strawberry blondes. That's Strawberry Blonde by Ron Sexsmith. I got a chance to share a stage with Ron about 4 years ago when I was just starting out. And he was an absolute gent. Such a pleasure to talk to. With my first real encounter with his work. I do miss, in a way, I miss doing some of those support slots around Limerick and around Ireland, because a lot of the time doing those gigs was my first time ever really encountering the musician I was supporting's work. And And I, you know, a lot of them prompted real journeys for me of discovery into their music, and prompted me to write new music, and kind of, yeah, weird. I miss them. I miss those gigs. I miss that time in my life when I was only starting out. If any of you guys are at that stage, relish it, enjoy it. I know it can be hard and exhausting, and there's a slog to it, but it's a really magical time as well. So enjoy it. So this is going to be my last song tonight. Thank you all so much for joining. Really, really appreciate having you here. If you haven't yet, the PayPal link is on the screen. It's in the comments. It's in the description of this. Please chip in if you can. If you can afford to, just ask that people chip in £4 each to support the artists that are involved in tonight's live stream and to support the cause we're supporting, which is Sera Husky and Animal Rescue. This video will be able to watch back. You'll be able to watch it all back in full shortly after the live stream ends. So do feel free to watch back. And thank you everyone who has been here tonight, who's chipped in, who's chimed in, who's commented, who's shared, who's liked. It all helps, and it all means a lot.
There are places I'll remember all my life, though some have changed. Some forever, not for better. Some have gone, and some remain. All these places have their moments. With lovers and friends, I still can recall. Some are dead and some are living. In my life, I love them all. But of all these friends and lovers, there is no one compares with you. And these memories lose their meaning when I think of love as something new. Though I know I'll never lose affection for people and things that went before, I know I'll often stop and think about them. In my life, I love you more. People and things that went before, I know I'll often stop and think about them. In my life, I love you more. In my life, I love you more.
Thanks, folks. See you in a couple weeks' time.